Lagrange's theorem, which tells us that in a finite group, the order of every subgroup must divide the order of the group, is one of group theory's most useful tools. For example, if a group has order 31, then we know that every subgroup must have order either 1 or 31, because 31 is prime. And of course, that means every subgroup is either the trivial subgroup or the entire group itself. Another example is that if a subgroup contains more than half the elements in a group, it must already be the entire group. However, Lagrange's theorem is also one of the easiest things to get wrong in a first course in group theory, because the converse, which would say that if a number divides the order of the group, then there is a subgroup of that order, is so enticing. So how do you know that a group of order 12 must have a subgroup of order 6?
Oh, it's Lagrange's theorem.
So how do you know that a group of order 12 must have a subgroup of order 6?
Because 6 divides 12, so it's Lagrange's theorem, right?
This is a Lagrange's theorem problem, right?
So how do you know that a group of order 12 must have a subgroup of order 6?
Lagrange's theorem, right?
Yeah, because 6 goes into 12.
Okay, it was a trick question. Not every group of order 12 has a subgroup of order 6. For instance, this group here is a subgroup of the group of permutations on four objects. We call it S4. Okay, this subgroup, A4, has 12 elements, and it does not have a subgroup of order 6. Well, how's that possible? Doesn't Lagrange's theorem say, hey, 6 divides 12, so it must have a subgroup? No, it doesn't. Think of it this way. If I told you that a car needs an engine to run, would that mean that any car with an engine will run? No, it may not have a transmission. Well, in the same way, just because a group has a certain order and a number divides that order, it doesn't mean there has to be a subgroup of that order. It may not have a transmission. To get around this problem, later on in the course, we're going to prove a couple of results which are partial converses to Lagrange's theorem. For instance, we'll prove Cauchy's theorem and then the Silo theorems. Also, we're going to see that in a cyclic group, the converse to Lagrange's theorem always holds. And if we use the fundamental theorem of finite abelian groups, we can extend the result from cyclic groups to all abelian groups. Furthermore, if a group's order is only divisible by a single prime, the converse to Lagrange's theorem will hold. So there are some things we can do. Now, in the future, if somebody says, hey, I have a subset of order 21 in a group of order 56, can it be a subgroup? You can say, absolutely not. 21 doesn't divide 56. That's Lagrange's theorem. But if they say, I have a group of order 56, must I have a subgroup of order 28? Because, hey, 28 divides 56? Well, you better think twice before you say, yes, Lagrange's theorem.